Good morning, dear students. Welcome to session 3 of science class. As you know, we have started with the chapter nutrition in plants. And in the last two sessions, we have discussed how plants obtain their nutrition and different modes of nutrition in plants. We have seen autotrophic mode of nutrition and heterotrophic mode of nutrition. So today, we'll discuss some more important topics. So let's begin. So our first topic for today is replenishment of nutrients in the soil. We know that plant obtains majority of its nutrients from the soil. So due to which soil becomes deficient in nutrients. So how soil gets its nutrients back, that we'll discuss. Plant absorb the mineral nutrients, especially nitrogen from the soil. We know nitrogen is required to make protein. So there is depletion of nitrogen in the soil. Usually crop require a lot of nitrogen to make proteins. After the harvest, the soil becomes deficient in nitrogen and other nutrients. So after the harvest, the entire nutrients from the soil goes to the plant. So soil becomes deficient in nutrients. So we add manures and fertilizers to the soil. Manure and fertilizer are used to replenish these nutrients, very important, in the soil. And these nutrients need to be added from time to time. So we have to add manure or fertilizers to the soil time to time so that soil gets its nutrients back. We know manures and fertilizers are rich in different kinds of nutrients. Fertilizers and manures contain plant nutrients such as nitrogen, potassium, phosphorus, etc. These nutrients need to be added to enrich the soil. Now, rhizobium bacteria living in the root nodules enrich the soil in natural way with nitrogen. We have studied about rhizobium bacteria in symbiotic nutrition. So rhizobium bacteria also helps in giving nitrogen to the soil and the plants because it can trap the nitrogen. So rhizobium can trap the nitrogen from the atmosphere and convert this into a simpler form so that plant can absorb. So it also helps in enriching the nutrients in the soil. So organic materials like compost, we have studied about compost in 6th standard. We know how to make compost. And other digging matter adds structure to the soil, improves drainage and also helps stave off diseases. So compost helps in preventing diseases and pests from the plants. Compost is the best and the most effective way to replenish the nutrients in the soil. So compost is also one of the best way to replenish nutrients in the soil because compost is also rich in different nutrients. Now, the next is crop rotation. So what is crop rotation and how crop rotation helps in replenishment of nutrients in the soil? Crop rotation is the practice of growing different types of crop on the same piece of land in sequence season. So what happens when on the same piece of land, we grow different types of crop? This is called crop rotation. Why we grow different types of crops on the same piece of land? Because if we grow only one type of crop in every season, what will happen? That one crop will have same type of nutrient requirement. So only that type of nutrients will get absorbed from the soil. So if we are growing that same crop every time, so that same types of nutrients will get absorbed and there will be deficiency of those nutrients. So in order to avoid this, we grow different types of crops on that same piece of land in different season because the nutrients requirement of different crops are different. It is done so that soil of farms is not used for only one set of nutrients that I've told you now. Crop rotation ultimately helps in replenishment of nutrients in the soil. So this is how crop rotation helps in replenishment of nutrients in the soil. Crop rotation helps to increase the yields and prevent crop loss due to pests and diseases. So these are the benefits of crop rotation. As you can see this diagram, in bed one, first year tomato was grown and in the second year or the second growing season, instead of tomato, carrots are grown and in the third year, beans are grown. So on the same piece of land, different crops are grown. Similarly, over here, different types of crops are grown in different season and over here also. So this is very, very beneficial for the crops or for the soil. Now, cover crops. What are cover crops? See, when no food crops are growing on a soil or on a piece of land, what happens? Farmer grow cover crops so that land must not remain uncultivated. Because if the land remains uncultivated, what will happen? Weeds will start to grow. And we know weeds are unwanted plants. They'll suck the nutrients from the soil. And again, soil will become deficient in nutrients. So in order to prevent this situation, farmers grow cover crops. Cover crops are plants that are planted to cover the soil rather than for purpose of being harvested. So in order to cover the soil, cover crops are grown. Cover crops are planted next to food crops in the middle of their growing season that help cover the weeds and attract beneficial insects. So cover crops also attracts beneficial insects and prevents the weeds from growing. A cover crop will increase soil quality by improving the biological, chemical, and physical soil properties. Cover crops also reduce the amount of water that drains off a field. As a result, a cover crop can conserve water and prevent soil erosion. We know that if the roots of the crops or the plants holds the soil firmly, so if there are no plants, what will happen? The soil will become loose, and ultimately soil erosion will take place. So cover crops also helps in preventing soil erosion. So these are the different ways: manures, fertilizers, compost, crop rotation, cover crops. These are the different ways through which we can replenish nutrients in the soil. Now comes the activity to prove sunlight is essential for photosynthesis. We have seen that photosynthesis takes place in the presence of sunlight. If there is no sunlight, photosynthesis cannot take place. So how can we prove? We will prove this with the help of activity. Let's see. Take two potted plants of same kind. So we have to take two potted plants. Keep one in dark for 72 hours and other in sunlight. So we have to keep one potted plant in dark and other in sunlight. Pluck the leaves of both the plants. So we have to pluck a leaf of both the plants, one which was kept in dark, another which was kept in sunlight. Place these leaves in beaker containing water and boil it for 10 minutes. So we have to take the leaves and we have to boil it in water for 10 minutes. Take out the leaves and now boil it in alcohol. So we have to boil the leaves in alcohol now using water bath. I'll show you the diagram of water bath. For 10 minutes, this removes the chlorophyll. So after boiling the leaves in water, we have to boil the leaves in alcohol. This removes the chlorophyll of the leaves. So leaves will become colorless. Take out the leaves and wash it under running water, and then we have to wash the leaves. So after washing the leaf, we have to perform iodine test with the leaves of both the plants. So we have to perform iodine test. So in sixth standard, we have studied about iodine test. Iodine test is a test which is used to detect the presence of starch. We know when we during the process of photosynthesis, leaves form carbohydrates or starch. So if the leaves perform photosynthesis, starch must have been formed. And we know that when we add iodine to any starch, it turns blue-black. Now observation, the leaf of the plants which was kept in sunlight turns blue-black. Means the leaf of the plant which was kept in sunlight turns blue-black means that it has performed photosynthesis and ultimately it has resulted in the formation of starch. This means the process of photosynthesis occurs in this plant. On the other hand, the leaf of the plant which was kept in dark does not turn blue-black. Means the leaf of the plant which was kept in dark does not turn to blue-black means the photosynthesis must not have occurred over there, because in the absence of sunlight, photosynthesis do not take place. So we have proved do not turn blue-black on adding iodine solution, because the process of photosynthesis does not occur and no starch is formed. So result, what we can say, this proves that light is essential for photosynthesis. So we have proved that sunlight is necessary for photosynthesis. If there is no sunlight, photosynthesis will not occur. As you can see in this diagram, we are boiling the leaf in water, then we are boiling the leaf in ethanol or alcohol. This is water bath. Ethanol is kept in a test tube. So this arrangement is called water bath. And at the end, we are adding iodine solution to confirm the presence of starch. So I hope you must have understood. Now, we have seen the leaves which are not completely green. We have seen different types of leaves. So do they contain chlorophyll or not? Let's discuss. Or do they perform photosynthesis or not? The leaves other than green also have chlorophyll. So these leaves also have chlorophyll, as you can see in this figure. The large amount of red, brown and other pigment mask the green color. So they have other pigments like red, brown and many other pigments which do not allow green color to appear. So they still have chlorophyll. So means they will perform photosynthesis. Photosynthesis takes place in these leaves also. So these leaves also perform photosynthesis. Because other pigments are present in excess, so green color is not visible, but still these leaves perform photosynthesis. Very important. Now, next activity is how to grow fungi. We have seen fungi follow saprotrophic mode of nutrition. We have studied about saprotrophic mode of nutrition, which feeds on dead and decaying matter. So how can we grow fungi? So what you have to do, take a piece of bread and moisten it with water. So we have to add water in it. Leave it in moist, warm place for 2 to 3 days or until fluffy patches appear on them. So we have to keep that bread after adding water for 2 to 3 days until fluffy patches appear on that bread. These patches may be white, green, brown, or of any other color. So these patches may be of different colors. Observe the patches under microscope or a magnifying glass. So we have to observe these patches, as you can see in this diagram, these green patches under microscope or under magnifying glass. We will see cotton-like threads spread on the piece of a bread. So these cotton-like threads we'll see on the piece of bread. These organisms are fungi. So these organisms are fungi. These green structure or white structures are fungi. We can observe that under a microscope or in a magnifying glass. Now, the next topic is plants are an ultimate source of food. We have, the name of our chapter is Nutrition and Plants. So plants are the ultimate source of food. We must say that plants are the ultimate source of food because all the organisms are ultimately dependent on plants for their survival. So plants are the ultimate source of food on this earth. So let's discuss. Only plants can prepare their own food. All other organisms are directly or indirectly dependent upon plants for food. So all the organisms are directly or indirectly dependent upon plants. Therefore, we can say that plants are the ultimate source of food. As you can see in this food diagram. So producers means plants, all the organisms, primary consumers, secondary consumers, tertiary consumer, all are dependent upon plants for their survival. So plants are the ultimate source of food. In all the food chain, we see that plants are the ultimate source of energy or food. But plants perform photosynthesis with the help of sunlight, with the help of sun's energy. If sun's energy would not have been there, photosynthesis would not have occurred. So we can say that sunlight is the ultimate source of energy. Plant is the ultimate source of food, but the ultimate source of energy in this universe is sunlight. So let's discuss. Plants prepare their food with the help of light energy from sun. Animals eat plants and use that same energy for their activities. So we animals and other animals, all the organisms consume that consume plants and use that same energy for performing different activities. Thus, we can say that sun is the ultimate source of energy. So that is why sun is the ultimate source of energy on this earth. Now, application in real life. So what does it mean? So what all we have studied, what are its application? What are its uses in real life? That we'll discuss now. So let's discuss. Kamal Mittal is an Indian environmental activist. So Kamal Mittal is a very famous environmental activist. As you can see over here, he is Kamal Mittal on the right hand side, the figure. And CEO of Pahadpur Business Center and Software Technology Incubator Park based in New Delhi, India. Kamal Mittal had a problem with breathing. He became allergic to New Delhi's polluted air. We know that New Delhi is very much polluted. So Kamal Mittal developed problem in breathing because of polluted air of Delhi. Kamal Mittal claimed to have discovered that three common household houseplants could help reduce pollutants in the air. So what happened? Doctors told Kamal Mittal to leave Delhi because he was allergic to Delhi's air. But what Kamal Mittal did, he discovered three plants which could clean the house, which would remove the toxicity or toxic air from the environment. The three plants are areca palm, mother-in-law's tongue, and the money plant. So he discovered three plants which could clean the air. The three plants are areca palm, mother-in-law's tongue, and money plant. As you can see in this figure, the areca palm, mother-in-law's tongue, and money plant. So these three plants can clean the air. Let's discuss areca palm. So first of all, areca palm. Let's discuss about areca palm. Plant areca palm converts CO2 or carbon dioxide into oxygen very efficiently. So this plant can convert carbon dioxide into oxygen very efficiently. The leaves of plant need to be wiped every day in Delhi and perhaps once in a week in a cleaner city. So the leaves of this plant needs to wipe out once in a week in a cleaner city, but in a Delhi which is very polluted, we have to wipe it out daily. The plants need to be put outdoors once every 3 to 4 months. So you have to keep that plant, it's an indoor plant, but you have to keep that plant outside for once in every 3 to 4 months. Next is mother-in-law's tongue. So the plant can convert carbon dioxide into oxygen at night. So this plant can convert carbon dioxide into oxygen at night also. Majority of plants do this process in the daytime only, but this plant has the ability to do this in night. Leaves of this plant need to be wiped in the same way as of areca palm. So the leaves of this plant is also need to be wiped out like areca palm. So next is money plant. We have all heard about money plant. This plant, money plant, helps to remove formaldehyde and other harmful chemicals from the air. So money plant has the special ability to remove toxic, harmful material or toxic materials which are present in the air, like formaldehyde. So it cleans the air. So these three plants helps to clean the air around us. So Mittal claims that if we were put in a bottle with nothing but these three plants, they would constantly produce enough fresh air for you to stay alive. So it claims that if we were kept in a bottle with nothing but these three plants, we will be alive. So this is the power of these three plants. So as you can see, this is again the figure of Kamal Mittal. So very important. So these three plants have large capacity to remove toxicity from the air. So this finishes our chapter. We have discussed all the major things of this chapter and application in real life related to this chapter. I hope you must have understood. Thank you for watching.